Hello everybody, welcome to How to Econ. Let's talk about gross domestic product or GDP, which is one way to measure the size of an economy. At times of recession or depression, when many people have trouble making ends meet, it is easy to tell how the economy is doing. At other times, when some are doing well and others are not, it is more difficult to ascertain how the economy of a country is doing. Therefore, there was a need for an indicator to measure the size of an economy and to monitor the economic growth of a nation. In 1937, the American economist Simon Kuznets proposed the original formulation of gross domestic product to be this much-needed economic indicator. The pictures on the screen is Simon Kuznets receiving the Nobel Prize in Economics in 1971. So what exactly is gross domestic product, or GDP for short? It is the value of all final goods and services produced within a country in a given year. Please pay attention here to the word final. That means GDP does not count intermediate goods. Each of the market transactions that enter into GDP must involve both a buyer and a seller. Therefore, we can measure an economy's GDP either by the total dollar value of what consumers purchase in the economy or by the total dollar value of what the country produces or supply. First of all, if we look at GDP from the demand side, then GDP will include all four components of a nation's demand: consumer spending, or we call it consumption; business spending, we call it investment; government spending on goods and services; and spending on net exports or trade balance. Net exports or trade balance is equal to the dollar value of exports minus the dollar value of imports. You can think about spending on net exports as the spending by foreign customers. When a country's exports are larger than its imports, we have trade surplus. When a country's imports exceed exports, we have trade deficit. Consumption expenditure by households is the largest component of GDP, accounting for about 2/3 of the GDP in any year in the United States. This tells us that consumer spending decisions are a major driver of the economy. However, consumer spending is a gentle elephant. When viewed over time, it does not jump around too much. On the other hand, business investment fluctuates more noticeably than consumption. So what do economists mean by investment or business spending? In calculating GDP, investment does not refer to purchasing stocks and bonds or trading financial assets. It refers to purchasing new capital goods, that is, new commercial real estate, such as buildings, factories and stores, and equipment, residential housing construction and inventories. Inventories that manufacturers produce this year are included in this year's GDP, even if they are not yet sold. From the accountant's perspective, it is as if the firm invested in its own inventories. Investment expenditure refers to purchases of physical plant and equipment, primarily by businesses. If Starbucks builds a new store or Amazon buys robots, they count these expenditures under business investment. Investment demand is far smaller than consumption demand, typically accounting for only about 15 to 20% of GDP, but it is very important for the economy because this is where jobs are created. However, business investment is volatile. New technology or a new product can spur business investment, but then confidence can drop and business investment can pull back sharply. A quick note about government spending is that a significant portion of government budgets consists of transfer payments like unemployment benefits, veterans benefits, and social security payments to retirees. The government excludes these payments from GDP because it does not receive a new good or service in return or exchange. Instead, they are transfers of income from taxpayers to others. Based on these four components of demand, we can measure GDP as GDP equals consumption plus investment plus government spending plus trade balance. Or we write it as GDP equals C plus I plus G plus X minus M, with C stands for consumption, I stands for investment, G stands for government spending, X is for the dollar value of exports, and M is the dollar value of imports. Remember that every market transaction must have both a buyer and a seller, so GDP must be the same whether measured by what is demanded or by what is produced. GDP measured by what is produced would have five components of a nation's production. They are durable goods or long-lasting goods, non-durable goods or short-lived goods, services, infrastructures such as buildings, roads, bridges, and change in inventories. Inventories are goods that have been produced but not yet been sold. In the United States, the largest part of GDP is services. I would like to add one more way to measure GDP that you might read or hear sometimes. Since everything a firm produces, when sold, becomes revenues to the firm, then businesses use revenues to pay their bills, wages, salaries for labor, interest and dividends for capital, rent for land, profit to the entrepreneur, etc. So adding up all the income produced in a year provides an alternative way of measuring GDP. This is why the terms GDP and national income are sometimes used interchangeably. The total value of a nation's output is equal to the total value of a nation's income. We should be careful to avoid the potential mistake in measuring GDP, that is, double counting or counting an output more than once as it travels through the stages of production. Recall that the definition of GDP is the value of all final goods and services produced within a country in a given year. Final goods and services are output used directly for trade purposes and consumption in general. They are different from intermediate goods. Intermediate goods are provided to other businesses at an intermediate stage of production, not for final users. They should be excluded from GDP calculation. Besides GDP, there are several different but closely related ways of measuring the size of the economy. We mentioned above that we can think of GDP as total production and as total purchases. We can also think of it as total income, since anything one produces and sells yields income. One of the closest cousins of GDP is the Gross National Product, GNP. GDP includes only what country produces within its borders. GNP adds what domestic businesses and labor abroad produces and subtracts any payments that foreign labor and businesses located in the United States send home to other countries. In other words, GNP is based more on what a country's citizens and firms produce, wherever they are located. And GDP is based on what happens within a certain country's geographic boundaries. For the United States, the gap between GDP and GNP is relatively small. In recent years, only about 0.2%. For small nations, which may have a substantial share of their population working abroad and sending money back home, the difference can be substantial. We calculate net national product, NNP, by taking GNP and then subtracting the value of how much physical capital is worn out or reduced in value because of aging over the course of a year. The process by which capital ages and loses value is called depreciation. We can further subdivide NNP into national income, which includes all income to businesses and individuals, and personal income, which includes only income to people. For practical purposes, it is not vital to memorize these definitions. However, it is important to be aware that these differences exist and to know what statistic you are examining. How about we take a look at some examples about calculating GDP? If you want to try them on your own, please pause the video now, otherwise keep watching. In each of the following cases, determine how much GDP is affected, if at all. The first one is Debbie spends $300 to buy her husband dinner at the finest restaurant in Boston. In this case, assume everything else stays the same or hold constant, we have consumption rises by $300. Therefore, GDP rises by $300 as well. The second one is Sarah spends $1,200 on a new laptop to use in her publishing business, but the laptop was built in China. In this case, investment rises by $1,200, but net exports fall by $1,200. So GDP is unchanged. The third situation is Jane spends $800 on a computer to use in her editing business. She got last year's model on sale for a great price from a local manufacturer. Current GDP and investment do not change because the computer was built last year, so it was counted in last year's GDP already. The last one is General Motors builds $500 million worth of cars, but consumers only buy $470 million worth of them. Consumption rises by $470 million, inventory increases by $30 million, and GDP rises by $500 million. Now, when talking about GDP, we have to be careful about the difference between real GDP and nominal GDP. Nominal GDP is the value that is not adjusted for inflation or the change in price. Real GDP is the GDP value that has been adjusted for inflation. Generally, it is the real value that is more important. Let's take a look at a simple example. Assume that we live in the wonderland where they only produce pizza and latte. We have the price and quantity of pizza and latte for 2014, 2015, and 2016 as shown on the screen. The nominal GDP for each year is calculated as the summation of the value of pizza and latte being produced each year using the price and quantity levels of each year. The value of pizza equals the price of each pizza times the total number of pizzas being made in a year. The value of latte equals the price of each latte times the total number of lattes being made in a year. So in 2014, the nominal GDP is a summation of $10 times 400 pizzas and $2 times 1,000 lattes, and it is $6,000. You can do the similar calculation to get nominal GDP in 2015 and 2016 as shown on the screen. By using the nominal GDP numbers, it might appear that national output has risen by more than 30% each year. But this conclusion could be highly misleading. Recall that we define nominal GDP as the quantity of every final good or service produced multiplied by the price at which it was sold, summed up for all goods and services. In order to see how much production has actually increased, we need to extract the effects of higher prices on nominal GDP. We could do this by using the price level of the base year to calculate GDP level. The base year is the year whose prices are used to compute the real GDP. In this example, I could arbitrarily take 2014 as my base year and use 2014 price levels to calculate real GDP as you see on the right side of the screen. For real GDP in 2015, we take the price levels of 2014 times the quantity levels of 2015. We get $7,200. This is only 20% increase from real GDP in 2014 instead of 37.5% if we use nominal GDP values. For real GDP in 2016, we take the price levels of 2014 times the quantity levels of 2016. We get $8,400. This is 16.67% annual increase instead of 30.9% when we use the nominal values. This calculation is long and tedious though. There's a shorter way by using GDP deflator. GDP deflator is a price index measuring the average prices of all final goods and services included in the economy. The base year's price index is 100, therefore real GDP and nominal GDP in the base year are the same. Recall that the base year is the year whose prices are used to compute the real GDP. We can calculate real GDP using the red formula on the screen. Let's take a look at a numerical example. Assume 2005 is the base year. We will calculate the real GDP in 1960, 2010, and the real GDP growth rate from 1960 to 2010. If you want to give it a try first, please pause the video now. Otherwise, keep watching. To calculate real GDP in 1960 using 2005 as the base year, we will take 1960 nominal GDP, which is $543.3 billion, divided by the GDP deflator, which is 19, divided by 100. We get $2,859.5 billion. Doing similar calculation, we get the real GDP in 2010 is $13,598.5 billion. Using the real GDP values we have just calculated, we can figure out the GDP growth rate by taking the later year's GDP level minus the earlier year's GDP level, then divide the result by the earlier year's GDP level, and finally multiply the whole thing by 100 to get the percentage change over the years. So we take real GDP in 2010 minus real GDP in 1960, divided by real GDP in 1960, and then multiply the result with 100. The answer is 376% increase in real GDP from 1960 to 2010. Real GDP is important because it is highly correlated with other measures of economic activity like employment and unemployment. When real GDP rises, so does employment. Governments report GDP growth as an annualized rate though. We call a significant decline in real GDP a recession. We call an especially lengthy and deep recession a depression. A recession or contraction lasts from peak to trough, and an economic upswing expansion runs from trough to peak. Peak is the highest point of output before a recession begins. Trough is the lowest point of output in a recession before a recovery begins. The economy's relatively short-term movement in and out of recession is called a business cycle. The most significant human problem associated with recessions and their larger, uglier cousins, depressions, is that a slowdown in production means that firms need to lay off or fire some of their workers. Losing a job imposes painful financial and personal costs on workers and often on their extended families as well. In addition, even those who keep their jobs are likely to find that wage raises are scanty at best, or their employers may ask them to take pay cuts. It is common to use GDP as a measure of economic welfare or standard of living in a nation. When comparing the GDP of different nations for this purpose, two issues immediately arise. First, we measure a country's GDP in its own currency. The United States use the US dollar, Canada, the Canadian dollar, and Mexico, the peso, and so on. Thus, comparing GDP between two countries requires converting to a common currency. A second issue is that countries have very different numbers of people. For instance, the United States has a much larger economy than Mexico or Canada, but it also has almost 3 times as many people as Mexico and 9 times as many people as Canada. Thus, if we are trying to compare standards of living across countries, we need to divide GDP by population. To compare the GDP of countries with different currencies, it is necessary to convert to a common denominator using an exchange rate, which is the value of one currency in terms of another currency. We express exchange rates as the units of a country A's currency that need to be traded for a single unit of country B's currency. We can use 2 types of exchange rates for this purpose: market exchange rates and purchasing power parity PPP equivalent exchange rates. Market exchange rates vary on a day-to-day basis depending on supply and demand in foreign exchange markets. PPP equivalent exchange rates provide a longer-run measure of the exchange rate. For this reason, economists typically use PPP equivalent exchange rates for GDP cross-country comparisons. Let's do an example. We will compare Bolivia's GDP in 2016 of 4.8 trillion bolivianos with the United States GDP of 16.7 trillion US dollars for the same year, given the exchange rate was 3.2 bolivianos for 1 US dollars. We will convert Bolivia's GDP from bolivianos to US dollars. We take Bolivia's GDP in bolivianos divided by the exchange rate of boliviano and US dollars, which is 3.2 Bolivianos for $1, we get Bolivia's GDP in 2016 was $1.5 trillion. The US GDP was $16.7 trillion in 2016, which is about 11 times that of Bolivia. The US economy has the largest GDP in the world by a considerable amount. The United States is also a populous country. Is the US economy larger than other countries just because the United States has more people than most other countries? Or because the US economy is actually larger on a per-person basis? We can answer this question by calculating a country's GDP per capita, that is, the GDP divided by the population. Let's do another example. We will compare the US and Norway's GDP and GDP per capita in 2018. If you want to give it a try, please pause the video now. Otherwise, keep watching. Here is the answer. Did you get it right? If you do, well done. If you didn't, don't feel bad because you will get better at this just after a few practices. Now, the level of GDP per capita clearly captures some of what we mean by the phrase standard of living. Most of the migration in the world, for example, involves people who are moving from countries with relatively low GDP per capita to countries with relatively high GDP per capita. Standard of living is a broader term than GDP. While GDP focuses on production that is bought and sold in markets, standard of living includes all elements that affect people's well-being, whether they are bought and sold in the market or not. To illuminate the difference between GDP and standard of living, it is useful to spell out some things that GDP does not cover that are clearly relevant to standard of living. First of all, while GDP includes spending on recreation and travel, it does not cover leisure time. The GDP per capita of the US economy is larger than the GDP per capita of Germany. But does that prove that the standard of living in the United States is higher? Not necessarily, since it is also true that the average US worker works several hundred hours more per year, more than the average German worker. Calculating GDP does not account for the German workers' extra vacation weeks. And while GDP includes what a country spends on environmental protection, healthcare, and education, it does not include actual levels of environmental cleanliness, health, and learning. GDP includes the cost of buying pollution control equipment, but it does not address whether the air and water are actually cleaner or dirtier. GDP includes spending on medical care, but does not address whether life expectancy or infant mortality have risen or fallen. Similarly, it counts spending on education, but does not address directly how much of the population can read, write, or do basic mathematics. GDP includes production that is exchanged in the market, but it does not cover production that is not exchanged in the market. GDP has nothing to say about the level of inequality in society. GDP per capita is only an average. When GDP per capita rises by 5%, it could mean that GDP for everyone in the society has risen by 5%, or that GDP of some groups has risen by more, while that of others has risen by less or even declined. GDP also has nothing in particular to say about the amount of variety available. Likewise, GDP has nothing much to say about what technology and products are available. The standard of living in, for example, 1950 or 1900 was not affected only by how much money people had. It was also affected by what they could buy. No matter how much money you had in 1950, you could not buy an iPhone or a personal computer with internet. The conclusion is a high level of GDP should not be the only goal of macroeconomic policy or government policy more broadly. Even though GDP does not measure the broader standard of living with any precision, it does measure production well and it does indicate when a country is materially better or worse off in terms of jobs and incomes. In most countries, a significantly higher GDP per capita occurs hand in hand with other improvements in everyday life along many dimensions like education, health, and environmental protection. No single number can capture all the elements of a term as broad as standard of living. Nonetheless, GDP per capita is a reasonable, rough and ready measure of the standard of living. That's all for now. Thanks for listening and see you next time.